गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. वेलकम टू लेक्चर ऑफ एनाटॉमी. टूडेज टॉपिक फॉर लेक्चर इज वेगस नर्व. सो वेगस नर्व इट इज द क्रेनियल नर्व. एंड व्हेन वी स्टडी एनी क्रेनियल नर्व वी हैव टू स्टडी दैट नर्व अंडर फॉलोइंग पॉइंट्स. इंट्रोडक्शन, फंक्शनल कंपोनेंट्स एंड न्यूक्लिया, कोर्स एंड रिलेशंस, ब्रांचेस एंड क्लिनिकल एनाटॉमी ऑफ nerve. So first we will see about introduction. Now this vagus nerve is the 10th cranial nerve. And why this 10th cranial nerve is called as vagus? Meaning of vagus in Latin is wandering. And as vagus has vagrant or wandering course starting from head, that is it starts in brain and traveling through neck, thorax and abdomen, and it is having variant functions also. Functionally, somewhere it is inhibitory, that is for heart it is cardio inhibitory. Somewhere it is acceleratory, that is for the musculature of intestine it is acceleratory, and for the sphincters of intestine it is inhibitory. Somewhere it is motor, somewhere it is sensory, and somewhere it is secretory, that is like the glands of respiratory system and GIT, it is secretomotor to these glands. It is also called as two-in-one nerve, as cranial part of accessory nerve is integrated into it. It is mixed nerve. Mixed nerve means it is having both components functionally, motor as well as sensory components. So this is about introduction. Now we will see about functional components and nuclei. As it is mixed nerve, it is having both components, motor as well as sensory. So first we will see about motor components. First is the special visceral efferent. As all of you know that special visceral efferent functional component of cranial nerve, it supplies muscles derived from pharyngeal arches or branchial apparatus. So this column, it is also called as branchiomotor column. And through this column, vagus nerve, it supplies muscles of pharynx, larynx, which are derived from fourth and sixth arch. Through this column, it also supplies muscles of soft palate, but these muscles of soft palate, they are supplied by the fibers which comes from accessory cranial nerve which joins with vagus. So and nucleus for this functional component, it is the nucleus ambiguous, which is situated in the medulla oblongata. So this is about special visceral efferent column. Now next is the general visceral efferent column. This general visceral efferent, it is also called as parasympathetic column. As all of you know that autonomic nervous system, it consists of two parts, parasympathetic and sympathetic. Parasympathetic, it is craniosacral outflow. That means its major part, it lies in the brain, and some part it lies in the spinal cord of in the sacral region. So this general visceral efferent column, that nucleus is dorsal nucleus of vagus, and this dorsal nucleus of vagus, it represents the maximum part of cranial outflow of parasympathetic. So through this general visceral efferent column, it supplies smooth muscles of trachea, bronchi, digestive system, then cardiac muscle, and also glands of respiratory system and GIT. So this is about general visceral efferent column. And nucleus for this column, it is the dorsal nucleus of vagus, which is situated in the medulla oblongata, that is in the floor of fourth ventricle. So these are two motor components. Now we will see about sensory components. So first is general visceral efferent, that is this vagus nerve, it supplies various organs, viscera, and general sensation from all these organs, that is carried by this general visceral efferent column. So it carries sensations from the visceral sensation from base of tongue, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, heart, esophagus, stomach and intestine. In the intestine, that is up to the junction of right 2/3 and left 1/3 of transverse colon. So this is general visceral efferent. Then next is the special visceral efferent. As you know, this special visceral efferent functional component for cranial nerve, that is it carries the taste sensation from tongue, and this taste sensation from tongue, it is carried by three nerves from the anterior two-third of the tongue. It is carried by facial nerve through chorda tympani. From posterior one-third, it is carried by glossopharyngeal nerve along with circumvallate papillae, and taste sensation from posterior most part of the tongue from soft palate and epiglottis, that is carried by this vagus nerve. So this special visceral afferent column, it carries sensations from posterior most part of tongue, epiglottis and palate. And nucleus for this is the solitary nucleus of tractus solitarius, which is situated in lower part of medulla. Then last column is the general somatic afferent, and as all of you know, this general somatic afferent, it carries general sensation, somatic sensation, that is the pain, touch, temperature. And this vagus nerve, it carries, that is pain, touch, temperature and sensation from the auricle and external auditory meatus. And nucleus for this functional component is the sensory nucleus of trigeminal nerve, which is situated from C2 segment of spinal cord in medulla and in the lower part of pons. So this is about various functional components of vagus nerve. Then various nuclei of these functional components. Now this nucleus, ambiguous, it belongs to special visceral efferent column. Then dorsal nucleus of vagus, it represents two columns, that is general visceral efferent and general visceral afferent columns. According to some authors, that nucleus tractus solitarius, its lower part is concerned for general visceral afferent functional component. So this dorsal nucleus of vagus, it is situated in medulla oblongata in the floor of fourth ventricle. Then this nucleus tractus solitarius, it is situated in lower part of medulla, and this nucleus tractus solitarius, it receives taste sensation from all three cranial nerves, that is facial nerve, glossopharyngeal nerve and vagus nerve. And last nucleus is spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve, and it receives general somatic sensations from auricle and external auditory meatus. So these are four nuclei of this vagus nerve from which fibers of vagus nerve arise. So this is about functional components and nuclei of vagus nerve. Then next we will see about cores and relations of vagus nerve. Now this vagus nerve, it arises from these various nuclei which are situated into medulla. The fibers arising from this nuclei, then they runs forward and laterally between inferior cerebellar peduncle and inferior olivary nucleus. And on the surface of medulla, it is attached to posterolateral sulcus of medulla. So this part, in this figure, this part, it is the medulla. These are the pyramids. This is olive, and the sulcus between this pyramid and olive is anterolateral sulcus, to which this 12th, that is hypoglossal nerve, is attached. And the sulcus between olive and inferior cerebellar peduncle, to which these three nerves are attached, that is glossopharyngeal, vagus and cranial accessory nerve. Then after its attachment from posterolateral sulcus, it is attached by 10 to 12 rootlets. These rootlets, they runs laterally towards the jugular foramina. Then these rootlets joins and form a single trunk, and it leaves cranial cavity by passing through jugular foramina, and it enters into neck. In its upper part, when it lies in jugular foramina, it represents superior ganglia, and this superior ganglia consists of pseudo-unipolar sensory neurons. Peripheral processes of these neurons, they carry the general somatic sensation from the auricle and external auditory meatus. Then at the base of the skull, just below jugular foramina, there is another ganglia, that is the inferior ganglia of vagus nerve, and it is having neurons, pseudo-unipolar sensory neurons. Peripheral processes of these neurons, they carry general visceral afferent and special visceral afferent sensations. Then after exit from cranial cavity through jugular foramina, it enters into neck. In the neck, both vagus nerve, they are having similar cores, but in thorax and abdomen they are having different cores and relations. Now first we will see about this cores and relations of right vagus nerve. Now it exit from cranial cavity by passing through jugular foramina, then it enters into neck. In neck it runs vertically downward and enters into carotid triangle. Now in the carotid triangle it lies within carotid sheath behind and between internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery and common carotid artery. Then it descend downward up to the root of neck, and from this root of neck it enters thorax through thoracic inlet by crossing first part of subclavian artery behind internal jugular vein. Then in the thorax it descend through superior mediastinum on right side of trachea, posteromedial aspect of superior vena cava and right brachiocephalic vein, and then it goes posterior to right bronchus to reach posterior aspect of root of lung. At root of lung it divides into branches, and these branches form the right posterior pulmonary plexus. From lower end of this plexus branches descends as 3 to 4 branches on posterior aspect of esophagus and forms the posterior part of esophageal plexus. From this esophageal plexus descending downwards fibers reunite and form posterior vagal trunk. And now this posterior vagal trunk, which is mainly formed by that right vagus nerve, it enters into abdomen by passing through esophageal opening in diaphragm and divides into gastric and celiac branches. Now in this diagram you can see that course of both cranial nerves. So this is the right cranial nerve that after its origin attached to this posterolateral sulcus enters into jugular foramina. In the jugular foramina there is superior ganglia, just below jugular foramina there is inferior ganglia, and it enters into carotid sheath. Then within this carotid sheath it lies between this internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery and right common carotid artery. Then it descend downward and at the root of neck it crosses that first part of subclavian artery and it enters into thorax through the thoracic inlet. Here it lies on posteromedial aspect of superior vena cava and right brachiocephalic vein. Then it comes on right side of trachea. Then it goes on posterior aspect of right bronchus, then to posterior aspect of root of lung where it gives rise to these pulmonary branches. Then it descend downward on the posterior aspect of esophagus. Here it forms the esophageal plexus. From this esophageal plexus that fibers reunite and form the posterior vagal trunk that enters into abdomen by passing through this opening, that is the esophageal opening in diaphragm, and in this into abdomen it divides into celiac branches and gastric branches. So this is about cores and relations of right vagus nerve. Now we will see about cores and relations of left vagus nerve. In the neck course is similar, that after exit from cranial cavity through jugular foramina, in the from this jugular foramina it enters into neck and then in carotid triangle. Relations they are same as that of the right vagus, lies in the carotid sheath behind internal jugular vein and left common carotid and left internal carotid arteries. Then at the root of the neck it enters into thorax by passing between left common carotid artery and left subclavian artery behind left brachiocephalic vein and enters into thoracic cavity by crossing arch of aorta anteriorly. Here it is cross, when it cross that arch of aorta it is cross anteriorly by left phrenic nerve and left superior intercostal veins. Then in the thorax it descend downward and passes behind root of lung, that is behind the left root of lung. At root of lung divides into branches that forms the left posterior pulmonary plexus. From this plexus it descend downward as 3 to 4 branches on enter branches on anterior aspect of esophagus and forms anterior part of esophageal plexus. From this anterior part of esophageal plexus, these fibers reunite, descend downward, and form from these fibers that forms the anterior vagal trunk. And that anterior vagal trunk, it enters into abdomen by passing through esophageal opening in diaphragm and divides into gastric and hepatic branches. So this anterior vagal trunk, it is formed by left vagus nerve. Now in this diagram, on this left side, this is the left vagus. In the neck, course is similar. At the root of neck, it passes between this left common carotid and left subclavian artery. Here it is crossed by left phrenic nerve. Then it crosses this anterior part of arch of aorta, and here it is crossed by left superior intercostal vein. Then it descend downward on posterior, enters into thorax, descend downward on the posterior aspect of root of lung. Here it gives rise to these pulmonary branches that forms the left posterior pulmonary plexus. From this plexus, it descend downward as 3 to 4 branches that goes on anterior aspect of esophagus. Here it forms anterior part of esophageal plexus, and from this anterior part of esophageal plexus, these fibers reunite and that forms anterior vagal trunk, which enters into abdomen by passing through esophageal opening in diaphragm, and in abdomen it ends by dividing into hepatic and gastric branches. So this is about course and relations of vagus nerve. Then next we'll see about branches of vagus nerve. So as this vagus nerve, it runs through jugular foramina, neck, thorax and abdomen. So we will see these branches region wise. So at first we will see about the branches at jugular fossa or branches in jugular foramina. So in jugular fossa, it gives two branches, meningeal branch and auricular branch, and both these branches, they are sensory in function. Now in this diagram, that is this black color, it is the meningeal branch, and this one is the auricular branch. Now this meningeal branch, it arises in jugular foramina from the superior ganglia of vagus nerve. It takes recurrent course, that means it passes through jugular foramina into cranial cavity, and it supplies sensory fibers to meninges of posterior cranial fossa. This is the meningeal branch. Then second is the auricular branch. It is also called as Alderman's nerve. Now this branch also arises from superior ganglia. Then after its origin, it runs laterally, enters into mastoid canaliculus, which is present on the lateral wall of jugular foramina. Then it enters into or traverses through the petrous part of temporal bone, and it emerges on the surface behind auricle through tympanomastoid fissure. And at this auricle, it divides into branches which supplies the posterior aspect of auricle, then posterior wall and floor of external auditory meatus and adjacent part of tympanic membrane. And both these nerves, they are sensory in function, and these peripheral processes, they carry these sensations, and neurons of these, they are situated in this superior ganglia. Central processes of these neurons, they enters into jugular foramina through this vagus, and that ends into spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. So this is about the branches in jugular foramina. Then next we will see about branches in neck. So in neck, it gives rise to pharyngeal branch, superior laryngeal nerve. It is the nerve of fourth arch. Carotid branches, right recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is nerve of sixth arch, and cardiac branches. Now first pharyngeal branch. So this pharyngeal branch, it arises from upper part of inferior ganglia of vagus. After its origin, it descend downward between external and internal carotid arteries up to the upper border of middle constrictor muscle. Then at the upper border of middle constrictor muscle, it divides into 3 to 4 branches, and these branches they take part in formation of pharyngeal plexus, and through this pharyngeal plexus, this branch it supplies muscles of soft palate except tensor valley palatii, which is supplied by mandibular nerve through nerve to medial pterygoid, and also through this plexus it supplies muscles of pharynx except stylopharyngeus, which is supplied by glossopharyngeal nerve. Actually, this pharyngeal branch it carries fibers of this cranial accessory nerve, which joins with this vagus nerve at the level of inferior ganglia or just below inferior ganglia. So this is about pharyngeal plexus. Now this pharyngeal branch and pharyngeal plexus, which is formed on this middle constrictor muscle, it is formed by pharyngeal branches of vagus nerve, pharyngeal branches of glossopharyngeal nerve, then branches from the sympathetics, and also pharyngeal branches from the external laryngeal nerve. So this is about pharyngeal branch. Next branch is superior laryngeal nerve. This superior laryngeal nerve, it arises from inferior ganglia of vagus, then it descend downward posterior to internal carotid artery, then it runs downward over this middle constrictor, then it divides into 2 branches, smaller internal laryngeal nerve and larger external laryngeal nerve. This internal laryngeal nerve, it is purely sensory in function. It is smaller, it runs obliquely downward in the gap between middle constrictor and inferior constrictor muscle to approach this thyrohyoid membrane. Then it pierces thyrohyoid membrane and enters into laryngeal cavity, and after entering into larynx, it supplies mucous membrane of larynx above the vocal cord, then it also supplies mucous membrane of pharynx, and this nerve, internal laryngeal nerve, it also carries taste sensations from posterior most part of tongue, epiglottis and soft palate. So this is the internal laryngeal nerve. Now this external laryngeal nerve, it descend downward accompanying the superior thyroid artery, and then it pierces this inferior constrictor muscle, and it ends by supplying cricothyroid muscle, which is intrinsic muscle of larynx. It also gives small branch to inferior constrictor muscle of pharynx. So this is the external laryngeal nerve. So this is the superior laryngeal nerve. Then next, carotid branches, that these carotid branches, they also arise from this inferior ganglia, and these carotid branches, they supply carotid sinus and carotid body, and they act as a baroreceptor and chemoreceptor. Then next branch is cardiac branches. These cardiac branches from this vagus nerve in neck, they are arranged in 2 groups, that is superior group and inferior group. These cardiac branches, they enters into thorax by passing through thoracic inlet, and they takes part in the formation of deep cardiac plexus, and very small part that goes to superficial cardiac plexus, and through this plexus, these cardiac branches, they supply musculature of heart, which is cardio inhibitory to heart. So this is about cardiac branches. And last branch in neck is the right recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now there are 2 recurrent laryngeal nerves, that is right and left recurrent laryngeal nerves, which arises from corresponding vagus nerve. Now right recurrent laryngeal nerve, it arises in neck, and left recurrent laryngeal nerve, it arises in thorax. So first we will see about this right recurrent laryngeal nerve, because these 2 recurrent laryngeal nerves, they are different in its origin, course and relation. So first we will see about this right recurrent laryngeal nerve. Here this green colored, this is the right vagus. Now this right recurrent laryngeal nerve, it arises from right vagus when it crosses anterior aspect of first part of subclavian artery. Then after its origin, it hooks around first part of subclavian artery from below. It goes behind common carotid artery then it ascends upward on the right side of trachea, then it runs upward in the groove present between trachea and esophagus, then at the lower part of this lobe of thyroid gland, it is related with this loop of inferior thyroid artery. It may go in front of artery or it may go behind the artery. Then it ascends upward on the medial surface of lateral lobe of thyroid gland. Then it passes deep to inferior constrictor muscle and enters into larynx. So this is the course of right recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now we will see about left recurrent laryngeal nerve. This left recurrent laryngeal nerve, it arises in thorax. So this left recurrent laryngeal nerve, it arises from left vagus when it crosses anterior aspect of arch of aorta. Then after its origin, it hooks round arch of aorta, goes posterior to aorta, then it lies between bifurcation of trachea and arch of aorta behind this left brachiocephalic vein. When it hooks around arch of aorta, it lies on left side of ligamentum arteriosum. Then it ascends upward in the groove between trachea and esophagus. Then it at the lower part of this lobe of thyroid gland, it is related with this loop of inferior thyroid artery. Then it ascends upward on medial surface, along this medial surface of lateral lobe of thyroid. Then it passes deep to inferior constrictor muscle and enters into larynx. So this is about origin, course and relations of both recurrent laryngeal nerves. Now we will see about branches of recurrent laryngeal nerves. Both recurrent laryngeal nerves, they are having the same branches. So first, that is the muscular branches. Now these muscular branches from recurrent laryngeal nerve, as this recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is the nerve of the sixth arch. So these muscular branches, they supply intrinsic muscles of larynx except cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by external laryngeal nerve. Now it gives rise to sensory branches, and these sensory branches, they supply mucous membrane of larynx below the vocal cord. The mucous membrane of larynx above vocal cord, it is supplied by internal laryngeal nerve, and below vocal cord, it is supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. Then this recurrent laryngeal nerve, it also gives rise to cardiac branches, which takes part in formation of this cardiac plexus. Then it also gives rise to communicating branches to sympathetic chain and branches to trachea and esophagus, which supplies muscles of trachea and esophagus. In the esophagus, that is the striated muscles of esophagus. So this is about branches of recurrent laryngeal nerves. Then other branches in thorax, that is cardiac branches, pulmonary branches and esophageal branches. Now these pulmonary branches, they are given in thorax and they form the pulmonary plexus, and through this pulmonary plexus, this vagus nerve, it supplies tracheobronchial tree, that is mainly musculature of bronchial tree. It is bronchoconstrictor and also glands of bronchial tree, and also it supplies sensory fibers to lung. This is about pulmonary branches. Then esophageal branches, they are given in thorax. These esophageal branches, they form esophageal plexus around esophagus, and that supplies muscles and glands of esophagus. So this is about branches in thorax. Now we'll see about branches in abdomen. So in abdomen, it gives rise to gastric, celiac and hepatic branches. Now we have already seen that this anterior vagal trunk, which is formed by left vagus nerve, it enters into abdomen and it divides into gastric branches and hepatic branches. Now this gastric branches from this left vagus, which forms anterior vagal trunk, it supplies anterosuperior surface of stomach except pylorus. This hepatic branch, it divides into ascending and descending branches. This ascending branch, it supplies liver and biliary apparatus, and this descending branch, that is also called as pyloric branch, it supplies pyloric antrum, pyloric canal and the first part of duodenum. This is about left vagus. Now this posterior vagal trunk, which is formed by right vagus, it divides into gastric branches and celiac branches. These gastric branches, they supply posterior inferior surface of stomach. These celiac branches, they goes to celiac plexus, and through this it supplies other abdominal organs, that is small intestine, large intestine, that is large intestine up to the junction, that is right 2/3 and left 1/3 of transverse colon, and it is accelerator to this muscles of small and large intestine, and also it supplies glands of the intestine, that is secretomotor fibers to glands of intestine. Then through the celiac plexus, it also supplies pancreas, spleen, kidney and gonads. So this is about branches of vagus nerve. So in the jugular fossa, there are two branches, that is meningeal and auricular, which are sensory. In the neck, it gives rise to pharyngeal branch. It mainly supplies soft palate muscles and muscles of pharynx, but this branch, it carries mainly fibers from the cranial accessory nerve. Then superior laryngeal nerve, carotid branches, recurrent laryngeal nerve, right recurrent laryngeal nerve and cardiac branches. Within the thorax, it gives rise to left recurrent laryngeal nerve, cardiac branches, pulmonary branches and esophageal branches. In the abdomen, it gives rise to gastric branches, celiac branches and hepatic branches. Now this diagram, it shows summary of branches of vagus nerve. Here this is the jugular foramina, this one is the meningeal branch, then this is the auricular branch, then this one is the, that is pharyngeal branch and superior laryngeal branch. These are the cardiac branches which supply heart, then pulmonary branches that supply lungs and the bronchial tree. Then in abdomen, it supplies stomach, small intestine, large intestine up to junction of right 2/3 and left 1/3 of transverse colon. It also supplies kidney, spleen, liver and pancreas. So this is about branches of vagus nerve. Then we will see about clinical anatomy. First, vagus nerve is tested clinically by comparing the palatal arches on two sides. So for clinical testing of vagus, it is tested by asking patient to open his mouth and to say ah, and then observing that palatal arches. If two vagi are normal, then there is the elevation of this palatal arches, and that uvula of palate, it lies, it goes backward and present in midline. But if there is paralysis of any vagus nerve, then on that side, that palatal arch, there is no arching or elevation of palatal arch, and uvula is pulled to the normal side. Now paralysis of this vagus nerve, it produces nasal regurgitation of solid liquids, that is due to the paralysis of the muscles of the soft palate, due to which there is no closing of posterior nasal aperture. Then there is nasal twang in voice, hoarseness of voice, that is due to the paralysis of muscles of larynx. Then flattening of the palatal arches due to the paralysis of muscles of soft palate. Then cadaveric position of vocal cord, and then there is the dysphagia, that is due to the paralysis of muscles of that pharynx. In this picture, you can see that this is the uvula, these are the palatal arches. Now this uvula, so it is the, there is the paralysis of muscles of soft palate on left side. So this uvula, it divides on right side due to unopposed action from unopposed action of this right side muscles, as there is paralysis of left side muscles. Then this clinical disorders of vagus, common causes for injury or paralysis of this vagus nerve, these are the expanding CP angle lesions, hydrocephalus, cerebellar tumors or meningiomas, aneurysm of carotid arteries, neck surgeries, brain stem vascular lesion, and mainly that is the lesion in the posterior inferior cerebellar artery syndrome. Other brain stem lesions like amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, poliomyelitis, and brain stem tumors. And due to these causes, that vagus nerve, it may get injured or paralyzed, and this leads to persistent hoarseness in voice, drooping of soft palate on the affected side, deviation of uvula away from the injured side, dysphagia with food passing into nasopharynx and trachea, loss of gag reflex, and hyperacidity and gastric ulceration. Then about this recurrent laryngeal nerve clinical aspect, there may be damage to only recurrent laryngeal nerve, and reasons for this damage or injury to this recurrent laryngeal nerve, that is maybe due to thyroid surgery, tracheostomy, esophageal surgeries, tracheobronchial lymph node enlargement that may compress this recurrent laryngeal nerve, bronchogenic carcinoma, esophageal carcinoma, and all these causes that paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve. Now this general somatic afferent neurons in the vagus nerve, that peripheral processes of these neurons, they form the auricular nerve to the external auditory meatus, and its central processes, they end into spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve, and it makes reflex connection with the dorsal motor nucleus of vagus. Due to this reflex connection between this spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve and dorsal nucleus of vagus, if there is stimulation of external ear, that is excessive stimulation of external ear, for example, that is at the time of removing wax, that is during the syringing external auditory meatus to remove wax, that may stimulate auricular nerve, and that may lead to cough, nausea, fainting, and even death due to the cardiac arrest, because this vagus nerve, it is cardio inhibitory to the heart. Now this low grade, this all these reasons, it is due to excessive stimulation or strong stimulation of auricular nerve. If there is a low grade stimulation of auricular nerve, which is also called as Alderman's nerve, that increases appetite by enhancing gastric motility. So all this is about clinical anatomy of vagus nerve. So all this is about vagus nerve, about its introduction, its functional components and nuclei, course and relations, branches, and clinical anatomy of vagus. If you have any difficulty, you can ask on WhatsApp group. Thank you.